This Tibet House video was originally recorded at Menla Retreat in Phoenicia, New York, March 2017. To learn more about this annual program, please visit menla.us.
Such being so, there is the mantra of transcendent wisdom. the mantra of great science, the unexcelled mantra, the uniquely universal mantra, the mantra that eradicates all suffering. It is not false and should be known as truth, the transcendent wisdom mantra as follows tadyata. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhi Swaha. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhi Swaha. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhi Swaha. Shariputra, thus should the Bodhisattva, the great hero, learn the profound transcendence of wisdom. Thereupon the Blessed Lord arose from that samadhi and applauded the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero. Excellent, excellent, noble son, so it is, so it is. One should practice the profound transcendence of wisdom in just the way you have taught it, and even the transcendent Buddhas will joyfully congratulate you. And the Blessed Lord has spoken thus, the Venerable Sharadati Buddha, the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero. Everyone in that audience and the whole world, with Uts gods, humans, titans, and fairies, rejoiced and all applauded what the Buddha said. Okay. So I'm going to do a little commentary, so keep the text. Okay, for a minute, there's a few things. So mendicants, you know, about Buddhist mendicants. Mendicant means one who lives on alms food. And, you know, most of people translate that as monks. But the mendicants were not really like Christian monks. They were, and that's why they were called bhikshu. They were called monk, has the meaning of someone who is solitary. But the mendicants were lived in communities and they studied together. And they simply, but they had vows of celibacy and poverty and nonviolence and truthfulness. Those were their four root vows, and then they had hundreds of other smaller vows, including vows not to slurp. At meals, they had 18 different minor slurping infractions not to commit. And because obviously they were all meditating, and so someone who slurped would drive everybody else nuts. So they had a special thing about no slurping. So that's one thing. Then, transcendence of wisdom is a kind of double meaning, prajna paramita, because prajna means genius or intelligence or wisdom, and paramita means that has gone beyond or transcendent. And so wisdom transcendence means it's a kind of wisdom that you go beyond having the wisdom, and you are the wisdom. And like generosity transcendence, there are other virtues, there are other 10 transcendent virtues or transcendences. And like the generosity one is where you become so generous that you don't notice yourself as a giver. You don't think of the gift as something that you gave. You don't think of the recipient as something other than you. It just sort of spontaneously leaves you or something. You just give it without noticing that you give it. So it becomes like a transcendent. You go beyond giving in giving. You take giving beyond giving, you take wisdom beyond wisdom, and that's a very important idea. And intrinsic reality we have already discussed. And then note, you ask me about women, note that Shariputra just asks about the noble son. And then Avalokiteshvara answers him, he says a noble son or a noble daughter. And that's in this text, which is 2,000 plus years old. So they were struggling with this all the way through, you know. They were, you know. And the Mahayana, you know, the Bodhisattvas, they were pushing the mendicants, who were mostly these Brahmin males, and who were more involved in the dualistic type of Buddhism and so forth. And we've already discussed the five mental functions, you know, the five aggregates or processes, you know, the material process, the sensational, conceptual, mental function, and consciousness. And we did that. And then the no-no is where, you know, that means that they're there, but they disappear when you really investigate them. It's like you can work on the surface with the superficial reality, but when you push past a certain point, everything disappears. And so the no, no, no is expressing experience of its disappearing, which doesn't destroy anything, it's just you've looked at it in too deep a way, and then when you return there, it's still there. So in other words, the realization of emptiness does not destroy anything. It just reveals its true relative nature. And once something is relative, then you know no particular perspective on it captures it. And it's elusive to conceptual capture. And so that's the way you experience a non-dual relativity. Then this no ignorance and no cessation of ignorance up to old age and death. This refers to the 12 links of relativity or dependent origination. And I don't want to go too time consuming to go over, but that's a very important sort of scheme that's used to meditate on. And then I commented, I think, on the other things. And actually, the Gate has a lot of commentary you can make about it. It has the five, there are these five different stages. The first two, one is called the stage of the accumulation, or gathering the stores of merit and wisdom. The second Gate refers to realizing Prajnaparamita on the stage of application, it's called. And then Paragate is the stage of vision, of insight. And that's where you have your first experience of being, of going beyond yourself. You have the first non-conceptual experience of selfishness, selflessness, to a certain degree. And you're never the same after that. You become what they call a noble person. Because a noble person is someone who has seen the self, seen through the self, by failing, in other words, sustaining the failure to find it, which I described to you already. They've had that experience of like a slippage of the self. And therefore, when they look at another, they don't feel the other is really different from the self because the self has disappeared in a certain way. And it therefore one is more lightly holds the sense of self as if it were an illusion, and one sees the others as selfless as well, in the same way you see yourself. So that's when you have that you become noble then, because you consider the perspective of the others as equal to your own perspective for the first time. In the first two, Gate, although you're doing virtuous things, you're still what they call an alienated individual, where you still feel separate from others and from the rest of the world on a visceral level. But after the Paragate, the vision or insight path, you have begun to see things from their perspective equal to your own perspective. Not to the degree of a Buddha where you're completely realize that you're completely like clairvoyant and telepathic and empathetic, and you completely feel yourself as being all the other beings, which is an inconceivable vast consciousness. Then Parasamgate is the meditation path, where you go down 81 different stages of descending from your first taste of nobleness in Buddha's beautiful definition of noble, as having the noblesse oblige of realizing the perspective of others. Then the Parasamgate is where you refine and deepen that to get all the levels of your unconscious visceral self-centeredness, overcoming it. And then the fifth one is called the path of no more learning, which is nirvana, and that's bodhi, simply bodhi, you know, the enlightenment. And swaha is hail to that, like celebrating, swaha, welcome. So that's the mantra is quite nice. So you sort of recapitulate the whole path, the five paths that they call it, when you recite that. And then Buddha is always saying, sadhu, sadhu, it's excellent, excellent. He does do that. He congratulates them. And then everyone is happy. Okay? So that's the Heart Sutta. That's great. And you know, it clears away. They say if you recite the Heart Sutra, actually, there's a wonderful Japanese no play, is it no or kabuki, rock, which kind, where there's a demon. And one monk in some old temple, and the monk wants to revive the temple and have it function again, so he wants to conquer the demon. And the demon will not, so then he has the Heart Sutra written everywhere on his body, so he will be immune to the demon. Not go through the writing of the Heart Sutra, it's written there around the bottom. And then he will spend the night, and then when the demon cannot penetrate him and hex him, curse him, kill him, he will then convert the demon, and then he will be able to revive the even goes in the ear. He put the letters in the ear, inside the ear. The demon goes in his ear. And they have actors all really covered with the Chinese character text and art. And then he gets all writhing and pain about the demon. It's a short Japanese drama I saw. They're funny. I love Japanese, but they're absolutely amazing. If you just stop to think about your heavyweight championship bout in America's 15 rounds, and it's all bloody and their brain is ruined. And then you think of sumo, and it's 15 seconds. It's the back and it's the psyche. One tosses the other, and everybody really gets hurt. But it's just it's a meeting of mountains. Miniaturized, it's tiny little.
That's knocked down, or what?
That's typical Japanese, but sumo wrestling.
Yeah, but what happens
once
this gets knocked down?
Yeah, either down or out of the ring. But they kind of tumble, but it doesn't really hurt them. They're so rotund, that they can bounce. But it just means the competition is just more mind and so small, because there's no need for blood and the heart will open down. Okay, so what do you want to do?
This video was brought to you in part through the generous support of the Tibet House U.S. membership community. To learn more about the benefits of Tibet House membership, please visit Tibet House U.S., including invites to special trips to study Buddhism up close and personal with Robert Thurman during his annual geographic expedition trips. Trips in 2018 include Mongolia and Bhutan. To learn more, visit bobthurman.com.